Hello and welcome to episode 26 of Crucible Bootcamp. I'm your host, Keen Koala, and today we're going to be covering a skirmish match on Timekeeper by a Voidwalker running a scout, specifically Mida, and a shotgun. So, two to the morgue in this case. Let's go ahead and get into it. So, most of this match that was sent to me, our hero, Berserker Owl, said that he was working on angles, and this is a solo match in threes. So, we're going to see him try to rotate around to attempt to get shots off first on these targets, and basically never really stick with his teammates just because there's no real communication there. Most of the time he's going to be with his teammates, it's going to be when he's right next to them or spawning next to them. So I like the patience with Mida here. Your teammate's pushing up and you're basically covering any kind of push through dugout if they shoot the box. So when you're in any kind of engagement without your shotgun out, it's very important to keep in mind that you need to create negative space between you and your opponent. Negative space means that you want to be moving away from your target as they pull into you when you don't have your shotgun out. Once you have your shotgun out, then it changes a little bit just because you can move into them slightly so you can close the gap and get your shot off first, or you can figure out how to bait them. If you're running a Stormcaller, you can figure out how to stay out of their one-hit range, but within your melee range. There's a lot of different things you can do once you have your shotgun out. But when you don't have your shotgun out, or if you don't run a shotgun at all, you always want to be moving away from your opponent. This plays a little differently with hand cannons just because of how Bloom works. But for the most part, don't move at your opponent if they have a shotgun out, or they're pushing you. You want to continue to create a gap of space in between you and them so you can actually kill them with your primary. If at any point you mess up and move into the opponent, that's when they're just going to shotgun you. Especially if they're just pushing hyper-aggressively into you. So, when we push into an enemy team, we have to be very cognizant of where we need to be looking, and we need to commit to the kill. Because in this case, on our radar, there's someone all the way around us. So when we commit, we have to go after this guy. Once you put pressure on someone, you have to continually put pressure on them to try to finish the kill. You don't want to give up free points, which is what ends up happening here. He's trying to hide behind cover, which is a good play normally, but because we're surrounded, we need to get this kill as quickly as possible. Look at where our teammates are. Our teammates aren't anywhere close to being able to support us. It's more likely that you end up trading with someone and they go up 50 points by making this kind of a hyper-aggressive play. And if you do ever push into them, you just need to keep your shotgun out the entire time. You're not going to have very many opportunities once you're in the middle of a team to get a primary kill. So here he goes to support his teammate, but he's just getting pushed by the two guys that just killed him earlier. It's important that when you pull around corners with your primary, again, we're creating that negative space. So as soon as we pull around and acquire a target, we need to be pulling back into cover almost immediately. Especially if we see two people that we knew were just outside on laser room, try to push in under this pool onto the salvage point. It's good that we're supporting our teammate in this instance, but again, we need to be creating that negative space and keeping that gap between us and the enemy player. It's a lot harder when you're in close quarters, so sometimes it's best not even to push into close quarters. So you see him just going to drop down here, get a free kill, go to push the relic. And again, the relic has changed now. There's a different scoring system, so it's actually, you should be capping the relic, but with at least two people. So the way it works now is the scoring the points It's the same. It's 100 per person and then additional 200 per person that capped or that started the relic. But when you disable it, the points for disable went up to 200, but only one person gets credit. So it, unlike before where you get the 450 points if one person disabled it, and you'd only get 300 maximum points for capping it, now it's 300 it's 300 points for capping it initially before it salvages, and only 200 points for disrupting it. So as long as you have two players cap the probe now, it ends up being point neutral as far as if no one dies. Obviously, if you die because you're trying to defend it, then it's, you know, it's point negative for you. But you can also make it point positive by having three players there. And then if they get one kill and then disable, that's fine. Like, it's not a, that's not a big deal. So you want to play the objective now in Salvage based on the new scoring system. So keep that in mind. So as we pull around Timekeeper, we need to be aware when we're moving through traffic lanes and when we're searching for targets. So you don't want to be looking for targets when you're in the center of a traffic lane, because you have no cover, right? You need to be able to make it back into cover without taking more than a couple of shots. If you're in the center of the lane when you're searching, you basically have to commit to a kill. And that gives your opponent all the options to move in and out of cover to disrupt your aim. We don't want to give our opponent that opportunity. So we want to be sticking to walls while we search down B lane into the mid area. Or we just need to avoid being in the center of this lane at all unless we're moving through it completely. So challenging there is fine. We're going to reposition. This is good. We want to reposition after we have our initial challenge because we didn't get any shots off on our opponent and they know exactly where we are. So repositioning here is good. As you can see, our opponent backed up, so we wouldn't even have had a shot there. So when you're searching for angles in a solo game of skirmish or salvage by yourself, you can't communicate with your teammates. You basically only have two decisions to make. You're either going to ignore your team and do your own thing, which can be bad further down the line, or you can stick on one of your teammates' shoulders, close to them, and always fire on the same target and always move when they move. So there are advantages and disadvantages to each one. The first advantage of sticking on your teammates is it's very easy to get kills if you're constantly with a teammate. You need half as many bullets to kill someone. And any decision that your teammate makes is potentially not going to get them killed because you're there to cover if it happens to be a mistake. So far, it's important to know that our hero, Berserker Owl, did not push the corner here on Timewalker or Timekeeper. So he's in back laser room here and his opponent is outside the pool corridor. Even though he has a shotgun, it's important to keep in mind what the enemy player is capable of doing. If we have a sniper here, as soon as we get to about this point here, when we try to push him from laser to pool, we're going to be in sniper range, and he's going to be able to body shot us very, very easily because there's no cover. We have to move out of cover into a choke point. And the opponent has the same issue, right? The opponent can't necessarily easily push into laser room because he pushes out of cover and he's a sniper. So this lane here and this lane here, it's very easy to move down and basically just shotgun them as they come out of the corner. So there are certain positions on maps where you kind of end up in a stalemate because both sides don't have a real good push into each other and you're banking on one teammate you're basically banking on the enemy making a mistake and pulling into you, right? And you can do this using radar baits. You can do this by actually moving all the way back to come off radar completely, having them pull around outside of cover and then pressing into them. There are a lot of options that you can do to pull someone into these areas where they make a positional error. But when you play against good players, they're never going to push through into the open without support. So good coordinated teams will have one person push into laser here, but at the same time, they're either going to be pushing straight down B lane to surround you, or they're going to send two people into this lane. So even if you get an initial shotgun on the guy pulling out of the open, he's going to be covered, and they're both going to be primary firing. So their primary fire could potentially just result in you trading with this person, and they getting a free res. They're going up 50 points. So it's important to keep in mind that sometimes you don't have to move on the map. Sometimes the location you have is strong, and you don't, and you can wait for the opponent to make a move. Or if they're not going to make a move, again, the 3-second rule, you need to reposition to figure out how you can attack where they're attacking. And if you do give up that position, think about if they decide that now that you're no longer in laser room, they decide to pull into laser room, how do you reapproach them once you're there and you've pulled all the way back out to C point? Do you go underneath tunnel and attack that way? Do you go back through mid lane? Because maybe they're not going to be in the back of the room. Maybe they are also going to be pushing down mid lane to you. There's different things that you have to do as you move around the map to get these kills that you're looking for. You shouldn't just be moving around the map blindly without really thinking about what you're doing. You always need to have a plan. You need to think, okay, if I abandon this spot and I go to a different spot, how am I going to react when no one is there? Am I going to go back to where I was, and how am I going to reapproach that? So you see here, his opponent nearly killed him, right? Basically, his opponent just missed a couple of shots, and he's in a situation where he's getting team fired. This is why you don't push through this corner on your own. He does a really good job of jumping to sort of create pseudo cover, but at this point, if this wasn't an auto rifle, if this was a hand cannon, he would be dead. Which ends up happening. He just gets team fired because two people are here and you pull out completely and completely expose yourself. So your normal inclination off spawn is always to push back to where you died, right? You want revenge. But again, if you're going to do that, you need to keep in mind the think, act, react. Keep in mind your tar. So if you're going to move to the same spot, one, you have to do it from a different location. So this is good. We're going from undersea instead of back through the pool corridor. And you need to react to whatever's going on. So someone's above you, and he's going to try to push and just primary down, dip back into cover. That's fine. But now that the enemy team knows we're here, now that we've peeked the third time, if this is a sniper, you're normally dead in this position. So just because you don't end up immediately dying here, if that guy had a sniper, in this case, just constantly moving up and down in the same location gives the enemy an opportunity to react to what you're trying to do. You don't want to peek the same spot, honestly, more than twice. I wouldn't recommend more than once. You should constantly be switching where you're attacking from, because you're going to make it so that they don't necessarily know where they should be aiming. And it's going to give your teammates that you can't communicate with an opportunity to move around the map to locations where they can get shots on the opponent as well. So because you're solo in this match and you have your super, you should just be burning it. You can't really coordinate with your teammates when they're going to use their super. And honestly, it's normally better to just assume your teammates are going to make poor plays with their super. You should just use it for free kills to try to get numbers advantages, which is very, very important when you can't communicate with your team. You shouldn't be holding on to it. So he goes to basically support his teammate that got two-manned. He's just cleaning up. So again, he's rotating around to try to find people. This is good. He's trying to find targets. And he's not necessarily pushing all the way out to get to them. He's still undercover. He still, you know, can defend himself if he's getting pushed with a shotgun. But once he gets to the point where someone shows up on radar, it does look like he doesn't really know what to do, whether to commit to the fight or whether to back off. There's basically three kinds of engagements in this game, and the timing of them. So the first kind is you aggressively pushing into an enemy player. So you attack first. That's when you go to those locations where they pop up on radar, and you're just bum-rushing them. You're getting in their face, you're closing the gap, you're finding ways that you can get shots on your target, and you're doing it first. So that's the first kind of engagement. The second kind of engagement is a more passive engagement where you let the enemy come to you, right? You're going to let them pull out of cover. You're going to do things like radar baits. You're going to do things like set up on a sniper lane, and you're just going to wait for them to pull into your sights, and you're going to punish them for moving around the map. This passive style of play is basically predicated on the fact that you're hoping that your teammate or the enemy player either makes a mistake or just you accurately predict how they're going to move around the map. It's one or the other. And the last way is when you both attack each other at the same time. That is when you see two shotgunners slide into each other. That's when you're both moving at each other, going to the 50-50. Say you're on Pantheon and you're both pushing to Cube. You're going to get to Cube at the same time. So that engagement is going to happen at the same time. And every one of those engagements requires a different skill set in order to succeed. So the aggressive one requires you to aggressively seek and acquire targets, and normally it requires you to have a short range weapon, right, like a shotgun. Now the defensive one, where your opponent is attacking first or your opponent is moving first, you have opportunities to use a lot more primary play. So, you know, your hand cannons, your scouts, your pulse rifles, your snipers, sometimes fusion rifles if you're using it defensively. And then at the same time is pretty much only going to be shotguns, because you're pushing closer and closer together in the engagement. So you want to kill your target in as short a period of time. Hey, relax. In a shorter period of time, to minimize your exposure, because normally when you push into someone at the same time, you're putting yourself into positions where you can't escape back into cover. You're going to be crossfired by enemy players a lot.
Hey. Off.
Off. 1 second.
Out.
Okay. So again, we finally see him use the super, but we've basically wasted 2 minutes not using it at all. And we only ended up with the one kill we were likely going to get anyway. So again, if you're solo, use your super, use it often. Getting those orbs for your teammates is more important than holding on to it to try to make a big play. Especially if you can't, again, if you can't communicate, you play the game very differently to be successful. Again, he takes shots and he's going to reposition. He knows where it is. Where he is. I would have really liked to see you backpedal there. I'm surprised that it didn't end up in you being dead or a trade. Mainly because that guy decided to get up and sprint instead of just shooting you at the range that you were. So again, that's sort of another false positive where, yeah, you ended up getting the kill, but you shouldn't have. You should have been dead there. Because of your positioning. So this is a good opportunity to use a shotgun bait. But again, if you're pulling into people, and he does a really good play here, you gotta either slide into them or jump. I would never recommend you sliding into someone if they're baiting you. You should always be jumping. And have your shotgun ready. Because they're going to be aimed basically at body level, waiting for you to come around the corner. If you jump around the corner, it's going to give you extra time to get a shot off like he did. And his opponent wasn't ready for it. So again, really nice movement here. Just constantly moving back and forth, back and forth. Looking for different ways to approach the enemy. The only issue that I'm seeing right now is that you don't really know where the enemy is going to spawn. So the next step for you, for our hero, Zerker Owl, is once you kill someone, you need to be pushing towards spawn and be setting up for them to come off spawn wherever they're going to go. So once you kill someone, look at the positioning of your teammates and then try to figure out what's the furthest point away from all three of you. And that's where they're going to spawn. And you need to push forward to try to find that person off spawn and not let them get into a rhythm. There's too much time. You're spending too much time searching for people as opposed to just knowing where they are or anticipating where they're going to be. So that engagement there, again, is another example of needing to create negative space. He's pushing at you and you're just standing still. If you're if you backpedal there, you likely trade, or it gives you enough time to pull out your own shotgun and kill him first. Nice grenade there. Guy isn't moving. Basically force him out into the open, which is exactly what ends up happening. Fortunately, we're dropping off to not completely engage. But we've just put a few shots on and back off, and our teammate cleans it up. This would be an example of following your teammates around. So you're just close to your teammate, you're shooting the same target. You never necessarily need to get very many kills, but you're going to get a whole lot of extra points because, again, 50 points for every assist. So if you wipe a team and everyone on your team gets an assist, that's an extra 300 points because it's 100 points per person, or 100 points extra points for assists if the two teammates hit targets on all three players. So that's really big. Assists are really important in this game, especially if you're playing as a team and not solo. But even solo, those points add up real quickly. So that was better. You kind of move back and then move forward. If you're going to kind of panic Nova like that, try to float higher just so you don't blow yourself up. Or get shotgunned, really. But for the most part, these are very solid plays. It's just a matter of sort of fine-tuning what you want to do on the map. Because you see, he's not really moving very far off spawn. And that's because he doesn't know necessarily where the enemy team is or how they're going to move. So here, that was really good as a solo player standpoint to see that, hey, my teammates just died. And the enemy team is three men up or two men up. I don't need to push into them. I have a good angle here. You know, if I get pushed like he does, he has a shotgun. He can just back up a little bit, pull out a shotgun, kill the other guy first. Make sure that when you do finish your engagement and you're low and you don't have enough health to re-engage, that you're pulling completely out of cover. Or completely out of the engagement space. You're pulling back all the way back into cover. So when you search for targets and you don't find anyone, not knowing where someone is just as good as knowing where someone is. Because that lets you normally move into the space where they aren't in order to continue to figure out where they actually are. So what do I mean by that? I mean that, let's show this on the map real quick. If I spawn and dug out like he has been most of the time and no one is on my radar, I know if no one is here, then they are going to be somewhere out here, right? Somewhere out here. They're going to be around the edges if I don't see anyone on my radar off spawn. So I think, okay, I'm going to push up to the spot I like here so I can check God Rock, right? And that's going to give me knowledge of if anyone is on beach or if anyone is in hallway or maybe a little bit out here, and then I'm going to have sight onto God Rock. But if nothing shows up at all and I don't see God Rock, that means that the only place that that the enemy players are going to be is in Laser Room. And now I can ignore having to look in these areas initially to try to find a target. I can use them to move around the map. I can use them to get closer to laser room. Or I can set up on an angle that I like and deal with any pushes that pull out of their position. But you have to recognize that when you don't see a target, that's your opportunity to know exactly where they are. All you need to do is just think, okay, you know, I've eliminated the options. They can't be here. They can only be in this area. And then you start your thought process all over again. Think, act, react. Do I go to God Rock and wait for them to pull into B lobby? Maybe I go onto the pillar and try to shoot into laser room? No, maybe I go onto pillar and wait for them to pull into the lobby here? You know, maybe I'll sit up by stairs and deal with someone coming through basement. There are a lot of different options that you can take in order to deal with people that stay in laser room. And if they decide not to move, well, you know, then you just push around where you can get an angle on them. Or can push into cover to get close with your shotgun. No single point on a map is completely defensible. There's always going to be weaknesses and always going to be ways to push. If that means you have to coordinate with your teammates, then you have to coordinate with your teammates. Even solo, you can still just wait for them to move, get impatient and move into them, and just follow them. So when all our teammates are dead, we should never, ever be pushing in to try to get into an engagement. Because more than likely than not, you're gonna end up being killed before you can do anything. Luckily, he gets a super right at the perfect moment, just to take a double. But if we didn't have our super there, then they end up going up 50 points, and our teammates are then gonna be in a situation where they're outnumbered again. They're gonna be 3-2 because you're dead. And they're going to be, if you're playing against good players, they're just going to push that numbers advantage. It's important to be very patient and just wait for your teammates to spawn up before you even decide to make a move. So, I mean, not really much happens for the rest of the match. It ends up going to overtime because they cap the point. If you end up crouching when you engage, you need to jump backwards, not backpedal, just because you basically get little to no space. You're not creating any space by being crouched and backpedaling. Unless you're using something like the last word where it's going to kill a little bit faster than they are going to get into the shotgun range. But even then, you should still be creating as much space between you and your opponent as possible. Or just pull out your shotgun. Okay, so now we're going to do something a little different. So, well, let's... All right, let's start with showing you guys some angles, and then we're going to go into the game itself. So there's a lot of different ways that you can move around the map. So I'm going to show you different ways you can move off spawn in order to go to those locations where you think people are, as a shotgunner and as a sniper. And show you different ways to approach properly so you can stay in cover, and you can look to see what these angles actually look like from the perspective of the person looking down the sights. And also you'll be able to see what it looks like from the opposite side. I don't have a helper this time, but next time I'll have a helper. So you'll actually be able to see what the head glitch itself looks like. So let's go ahead and launch this. Okay. So I'll start with some basic trials tips that I like doing on Timekeeper. Because everybody wants to know about trials. Okay, let me invite you to boxes. We'll get you in here.
Alpha team. This combat zone is active. You know what to do.
Okay, let me know when you're on. Alright, so if I spawn on Alpha spawn, where I am now, there's a couple things you can do to snipe the 50-50, which is this lane here. Most people snipe here. You can either... You always want to be in cover, right? You want to be next to cover. So here, as you can see, when I scope in, I have part of my body hidden. Right, so this is really hard to see. Well, boy, it's hard to see if on either side. But you can also jump on top of this here. Because if the 50-50 is head level, and you go above head level where people don't expect you to be, again, try to get undercover here so you can see I'm not exposing myself. Same thing on the other side. You want to come all the way up here. You can see, you can move in and out of cover really easily. From the other side, I really don't like engaging this spot at all. It's really dangerous if I spawn on Bravo, which ends up being out here. Right here. You spawn in this location. Normally, by the time you get to this position here, you're getting grenaded. And if you peek around the corner, they could be in any one of those spots that I showed you. Here. Be in any one of those spots. All right, let me get boxes in here. Alright, so if I'm on Bravo side and I want a setup, a really good setup is to have one person on Godrock here, crouch down normally so you can have a head glitch, and you can see into B here. You can come up onto the pillar here, which lets you see into laser room, and also lets you see into mid, as you can see, our hero, battle boxes. So you want to go out on the head glitch that's over by dugout, behind you. Yeah. Alright, so as you can see, you want to crouch down. Alright, see, when you crouch where boxes is, you get a really nice head glitch onto anyone on Godrock. So that's a really good spot on this map if you want to challenge Godrock, because this is a very tight spot, like tight shot to make as a sniper. If you don't know where someone's head level is at this point, you're almost always going to miss, because you're going to shoot there normally next to them, and you can't really challenge with primary from this distance if their head's there. It's really hard to hit. So you want to switch places with me, and I can show you what it looks like from the other side. So from the other side, you can see, crouch down, right there. That, he has a head glitch there, and I have a head glitch here. Again, you have to know where head level is at this point. Most people are standing up where boxes is, so it's a lot easier shot for you to make compared to him. Okay, so if you're in B here, let's say I spawn Alpha and I come out into mid, and boxes is out on a Godrock there. I'm basically safe when I get behind this pillar in front of me here. So you need to slide. If you're going to push into mid, you need to jump or slide into the pillar and try to make sure you don't go quite as far as I do. So once you're behind pillar, then you can decide where you want to go. Sometimes it's good to come up here in primary. Sometimes it's good to push around the corner and try to get a snipe. But most importantly, you want to take out this explodey box. Because if you don't, when you push forward to try to challenge using your cover, they're going to explode it and you're going to die. It's going to be embarrassing because no one likes to die from hazards. The other spot that you should go out here is actually on here. How's that ghost up here? You can go on this pillar here, and that's going to let you see that same push where they were behind cover. And it's pretty difficult for them to attack you from where boxes is now, right? I can just completely avoid him and deal with the left half of the B-ring. Or if I have to, I can peek all the way around and cover that area, cover any jumps. And you can see all the way back into dugout here and over by the outer door. So I want you to stand over here on the laser pillar so I can kind of show what it looks like. All right, so you can see he's up there. That's a really weird spot, right? So that's a good spot to snipe this area. That's what it looks like here. He's completely exposed there. We can go all the way around here. That gives us a really nice shot on him. Really easy for us to dip, right? It only takes us just a brief fraction of a second to come back into cover. And then a lot of people go down here, which I don't really like. But if you go here, it gives you the option to drop straight back. So let's switch spots. You go over on the pillar now. So you see from those locations, you're basically exposed where I am. But from where he is, dip back into cover. See how easy that is for him to dip back into cover? And I basically have no shot whatsoever. And do it from the other side. And dip back into cover. See how quick that is? You don't really have much time to get a shot. And someone that's up there looking down where I am right now, my elevation isn't really changing. Even if I go onto the stairs, it's not a huge change. That's why we come up here if we have to challenge or we try to get a head glitch on the steps itself. But that head glitch doesn't work if they're on top of the pillar. If they're where our boxes is now, this is a head glitch. But if he goes to the top of the pillar, you basically negate this head glitch altogether. Okay, so let's show why it's bad to push around this corner. So stay where you are, boxes. All right, if I'm in this corner, you can see, if I push through, I'm exposed. I have no cover. Where am I gonna go, right? I can't go anywhere. And boxes, if he hugs this wall as I come through, if I engage him, he can pull back into the left and pull into cover. So back into your right. He can pull back there. So if he basically stays at the apex of the turn here, he's gonna see me come through, whether with my slide or my jump, and he's going to be able to pull into cover. And the only way I'm going to be able to track him is if I pull out of cover, exposing myself. If I pull into this location, anyone back here is going to kill me. Anyone over there sniping is going to get shots on me. And I have nowhere to go. If I die, I'm basically too far away from the door for them to properly cover the orb. And I get completely surrounded by my orb gets completely surrounded by the enemy if I'm in this location. If you have to push through this door, you want to push all the way to the back of the room, here. This is going to give you the opportunity to move freely and deal with elevation changes. So you can move up behind cover. You can move sweep to the left or ignore the left altogether and move to the right. And just all you got to do is aim high in case someone comes over the top of you. That's all you got to do. Know that if you do decide to take this flank route, you don't have an escape route. You normally have to kill your way out to go through under here. You're gonna have to kill at least one person, and hopefully you'll be able to get out. Once you get to this point and back dugout, you're normally safe. So we saw that Berserker Owl was basically spawning here in back dugout. So there's a couple ways you can move around the map, and one way that we never really saw him use until the very end of the game. And that's through back donut. So if you come through back donut, if you're a sniper, you want to go through here. Or if you do decide to go onto donut, do not go all the way on top and do not push through. Because as soon as you get here, you don't have enough time to back all the way down before you die. So you want to stay on this secondary edge of donut. Because it's going to let you create a head glitch if you crouch. And what, where you want to be looking is across, around this rock, onto the special area, and onto the god rock, and then over here onto the pillar. Those are the areas you want to be looking at. You want to scan them with your primary real quick, acquire your target, scope in. That's it. Scan, acquire, scope. So that's one way you can rotate off that particular spawn. The other way, if you think they're on laser room, if you're a sniper, again, you just come here and you have a perfect shot. This angle doesn't change. Look at this angle when I'm behind cover, right? Look at me move outside of cover, completely exposing myself. Look at me move all the way here. The amount of area that I can see around boxes doesn't change. Except in this location, I have half my body hidden. So boxes switch spaces with me. So again, if he's going to snipe you there, that's all I see is his head. That's it, if he's behind cover. But if he exposes himself like that, I get a body shot very easily. Okay, so in Owl's case, he's a shotgunner. You don't want to challenge this with your primary unless it's long range, a pulse or a scout. If you have an auto or a hand cannon, this is too far away. So what you want to do is you want to slide into cover because now he can't see me. And you want to slide underneath. And this gives you options. If you think he's going to push straight ahead of you, you can rotate straight back. And you can go around behind him. Because you know, by the time you get to this location, he's normally going to be back here waiting for you. Here. This lets you push this corner and become a flank through the back of the room to get close to your shotgun. Especially if you're using Mida, you're going to get there really fast, right? Your other option, if you don't think he's going to push forward, is you can come back up here because he thinks you're going to be below and then sweep around above him with your shotgun. So let's talk about pushing outside with the shotgun. We're spawning in dugout again and we have a shotgun and we want to get to God Rock. Our goal is to get to God Rock. So there's one option you should never take with a shotgun, and there's one option that you can take. There's a few that you can, other than that back donut area. But as a shotgunner, if you ever get spotted, you got a primary, right? You have to use your primary once you get spotted. Your flank is only as good as how much your enemy opponents are paying attention. If they never pay attention to you, you can just walk right up to them and shotgun them. But if they know you're coming, that's when you need to establish angles and deal with how you're going to approach with your primary. And then if they push you, that's when you go pull out your shotgun again and let them close the gap. So the route I want you to take if you're a shotgunner is to come under pool here. So once you get to this location, this is your most vulnerable location. You have to push all the way, either straight forward and shotgun, or hug wall, come around, shotgun here, or completely escape and pull back into laser room. But again, when you come out into the pool proper, you need to continue to move. If you stay here on A point, you will die. You will just die. You won't have a chance. Because there's no cover around you, right? There's no real way for you to get into cover. The only way you can do that is by creating a change in elevation for your opponent where your body comes underneath and he can't see you anymore. He has to pull all the way out here, and if he pulls there, we're in shotgun range, right? And that's what we want. We basically created a situation where we didn't have to push all the way into them. They're just going to pull into us because they're greedy for kills. Most players, they're going to be greedy for kills. The one place I don't want you to push is if you're a shotgunner is in through B. Because you're going to get As you can see, he's just going to hardscope me. And once I get here, what? I'm going to get body shotted. So if I'm body shot mid-slide in this location, I have nowhere to go. I can try to get forward, but if I'm super weak, he's just going to jump straight up. And he's going to take care of me. I'm not going to have a chance really to do anything. Because if he jumps, then he's going to stay out of that shotgun range that I worked so hard to get to. Yep. Better snipers will just hit you in the face as you round this corner. You have to slide through this corner mostly. And then at this point, you normally have to slide this way. And then the sniper's going to be like, okay, he's going through donuts, so they're going to meet you here. I wasn't even skating, and he met me right here. If I skated here, he would be mid-jump, but even then, if he has a shotgun, or his teammate is rotating that way, I'm going to die as soon as I get to my proper location on donut. So I have to hug my cover if I'm going to rotate this way, and I basically have to expect them to go there. And I need to primary them when they come into donut. You want to bait them into... If you want to give your opponent perfect information, you want to pull them into the location where you can get shots off. And sometimes it's good to give your opponent, to let your opponent know what you're going to do. So if I'm here and I get body shotted and I come this way and I'm going to stay on radar and they know that I'm going to go to donut, all I have to do is wait here instead of pushing forward. I just wait at the corner under cover and I deal with him when he gets to that location. And if things go wrong, let's say I'm still weak, I can get two shots or one shot off or whatever it is, and I can pull back into cover. I can go back around. Most of the time, this sniper here isn't going to flank you. Most snipers aren't comfortable with their primary game. So there, he's not going to... The sniper is going to still be hardscoped there, waiting for you on donut. That all you have to do at that point is slide here and run away. And then you reset the fight, and you can approach basically the same way if you want. Again, stopping... waiting for them to come to you, pulling back. Or coming out by this rock, same thing. Get to the rock, you can go on top of the rock if you want. You can go to the side to get a better sniper angle, depending on what weapon you're using. Again, just pull back into cover. Now look around, what are your options? If they happen to push you through donut, you can come back to where you came from, or you can go through the door. Keep in mind that as soon as you get here, you're completely exposed, so it has to be quick. You need to be sliding here. Just like that. Two slides, and you're back undercover. So I'll show you that again. So if you're exposed, you can't fight, you're weak, whatever. And slide. Jump. Now you're back undercover. All right. So... that's pretty much all I have for you guys this time. If I was going to give Zerker any tips, it would definitely be to be aware of creating negative space. Making sure that if you don't have your shotgun out, you're backpedaling, you're creating a gap, you're jumping backwards, you're moving laterally if you have to deal with Juggernaut. Just constantly be moving. Don't just sit in one spot and wait for someone to come and kill you. That's what you don't want to do, and that's why a lot of people think things like Juggernaut are too good, because they aren't moving away from the target. Or if they do move, in Juggernaut in particular, if you merely just move straight backwards, you're not dealing with the Juggernaut shield. You have to move side to side to deal with Juggernaut as they push at you. So again, just create that negative space and you'll be fine. Yeah, I've been King Koala. This has been Crucible Boot Camp, and class is dismissed. Bye.